Sometimes numbers can unravel truths never told. And probably this is why numbers are so often forged, faked, and altered. No one is really concerned about telling you the truth, especially when these numbers are linked to money figures. Projections and rates are frequently misinterpreted or mistakenly used as a quick fix-up to much larger wounds. That's what professor of political economy at Carnegie Mellon and visiting fellow at Hoover Institution Allan Meltzer had repeatedly warned in his work throughout the past 25 years. Even though Meltzer wasn't noted by the masses while alive, he is considered among many American economists as a significant expert in monetary policy, and his work still causes impact in recent days. Born in 1928, on the verge of the Great Depression, Meltzer had seen enough to understand how institutions work in times of crisis. He wrote the three-volume analysis, A History of the Federal Reserve, as he chaired the Shadow Open Market Committee, a group that would regularly meet to discuss the policies of the Federal Reserve. The economic policies that were developed since 2008 were definitely not approved by his views, as he states that it was definitely the biggest economic mess he had seen since the 1930s, and later on affirming that America has never had such a problematic future. In June 2010, in an opinion piece he wrote for the Wall Street Journal called Why Obamanomics Has Failed, Meltzer has pointed out how the uncertainty about future taxes and regulations was the most dangerous obstacle of the economic growth. In his studies, he explains how the administration's stimulus program had bumped. The two main reasons he uses to justify Obamanomics' fiasco are related to the neglect of the long-term costs and its consequences by the administration economists and their outside supporters, and also due to the Congress and administration behaviors which had led to more uncertainty about the economic future. Meltzer unfolds that the earlier spending was a short-term exit in a long-term path. Using part of the financed money to direct into temporary tax cuts didn't seem effective, unless these cuts were expected to last enough, so consumers could save the proceeds and had paid down their debt. But even so, it disregards the role of expectations in the economy. The other cut of the stimulus was intended to relieve state and local governments of their budget deficits, transferring a deficit from the state to the federal government, but only creating a very small change. Because despite delaying the incoming rise of unemployment rates for a while, all benefits that were given back then had enormously increased the public debt. On the other hand, investors had been pushed towards riskier assets because of their low interest rates. But when these rates rise again, which is only a matter of time, as we well know, the value of these risky investments will drop, and the investors are going to be deeply injured by that. On top of all of this, there is still the fact that interest payments on the public debt will rise, increasing the budget of deficit even more. There is no doubt that prices have been rising rapidly in some sectors of the economy, and the marketplace is facing major distortions. However, it is concerning that large, too-big-to-fail banks like Goldman and Bank of America, as they're referred to by economy website Zero Hedge, reported they had made profits in the market on approximately 95% of trading days in 2012, which makes us wonder about how manipulated this game is. Because, hey, let's face it, it's almost impossible for a trader to be that competent. Just as Peter Schiff had expressed, printing money is to the economy what taking drugs is to a drug addict, meaning that regardless of the momentary sensation of relief, there is an increased chance of an incoming doomed future. Back then, the national debt counted billions. Nowadays, it had hit the trillion mark. By now, we can all catch a glimpse of the early stages of the downfall of the American dollar. And since the economic collapse has started, there is a countdown for the whole system to break. Meltzer seems to have a lot less reason to dissimulate the truth than those who are currently involved in forming policies. Again, in May 2014, he appears in a piece of the Wall Street Journal, giving his almost prophetic take on where the economy was headed. According to his studies, in that time it was already possible to foresee an explosion in food prices, as maintained by the U.S. Department of Agriculture. The Consumer Price Index has increased even before seasonal adjustments, raising alarms among economists and investors because there wasn't a moment in history where a country that financed big budget deficits with large amounts of central bank money had avoided inflation. And the U.S. has been printing money carelessly for many years. In the report, he informs that the Obama administration had run huge budget deficits every year, in which, alongside with the Bush administration, had amounted to $6.7 trillion from 2006 to 2013. The Federal Reserve financed almost $3 trillion of these deficits by purchasing Treasury bonds and notes, and it also had purchased massive amounts of mortgage-backed securities, leaving more than $2.5 trillion of idle reserves on bank balance sheets, fueling a bigger inflation once lending and money growth rates climb. He said, to avoid the kind of damaging inflation the U.S. experienced in the 1970s and early 80s, the Fed could raise interest rates, including the interest it pays banks on reserves, including banks, to hold most of the $2.5 trillion of reserves idle. However, high interest rates usually discourage borrowing and lending, conducting the economy into a damaging recession, as is the one we are living in right now. Now, the Fed's model of inflation relies on the late 1950s Phillips curve, which charts what economist Alban William Phillips had foreseen as a tendency for the inflation to fall when unemployment is high and rise when unemployment is low. But even Fed's chairwoman Janet Yellen had admitted that this wasn't a good standard to measure inflation. And two of the most successful Fed chairmen, Paul Volcker and Alan Greenspan, also considered the Phillips curve unreliable, as the Fed's forecast seemed to ignore the universal status of inflation as a result of excessive money growth relative to the growth of real output. Meltzer continues by explaining that the current economic dilemma actually started in 2008 when the Fed forcefully prevented a collapse of the payment system. But by focusing too much on distracting monthly and quarterly data while ignoring the longer-term effects of money growth, the Fed lost its track. Even though the unemployment rate has gradually declined after 2008, which is not the case anymore, as we mentioned in previous videos, the rise in asset prices of equities didn't stimulate growth by inducing investment in new capital. He quotes, "Investment continues to be sluggish." With all that on the table, we notice how many of the Fed's policies have damaging consequences, such as the ultra-low interest rates, which escorted retired citizens to take significantly greater risks than with bank certificates of deposits that many of them were used to rely on, and also by not letting bondholders to avoid when interest rates rise, as they've started to do. Back in 2014, the professor already had alerted the Fed that they should have noticed that instead of a strong housing market recovery, not many people were paying their first mortgages. Many of the sales were to real estate speculators who financed their purchases without mortgages and are now renting the houses, planning to resell them later, exactly what we mentioned a couple of videos ago, remember? Similarly, he defended that the Fed should have recognized that the country's economic problems weren't linked only by monetary factors, and instead of keeping interest rates low to finance deficits, it should have explained that costly regulation, wasteful spending, and repeated threats to raise tax rates were holding back the economic recovery. Look, if we compare the Obama administration with Kennedy's and Johnson's in the 60s, Reagan in the 80s, the opposite course was taken. The late presidents used to promote growth first and redistribute it later. However, by sacrificing growth for redistribution, the Obama administration has got none. In spite of the attempts to increase redistribution to favor middle and lower income groups, the policies adopted by the Obama administration and supported by the Fed have accomplished the complete opposite. That is to say, inflation is in our future. Allan could see years ago that the food prices were flowing as they did in the mid-60s. This was way before the current health crisis appeared in the picture. The economic collapse has been announced for years, and now it's finally hit our door. The Trump administration has been a continuation of deficit spending. Meltzer predicted that postponing the day of reckoning would probably make things worse in the future. And the future is now.